Avant de commencer cette présentation, je voudrais quand même remercier, faire quelques remerciements à la suite de la thèse. Donc, en particulier, je remercie bien sûr mes encadrants de thèse. Et donc, c'était une thèse franco-britannique entre l'Université de Sheffield en Angleterre donc, et l'ENSTA Bretagne à Brest. Et naturellement, je remercie donc, Luc Jolin, Ludmila Mihailova, Fabrice Lebars, Sandor Verès également. Et donc, Luc également dans la salle ici. Et même plus généralement, je remercie aussi les équipes de Brest et de Sheffield, tous les anciens chercheurs, les doctorants, le personnel, les ingénieurs, etc., qui ont contribué vraiment à cet environnement de travail très fructueux, je dirais, et puis très motivant surtout. Donc c'est aussi très important dans le cadre d'une thèse. Et naturellement, je remercie également la DGA pour son support financier, qui, grâce à elle, du coup, permet toute cette activité autour de ces thématiques de recherche très intéressantes. Donc, on m'a demandé de faire la suite de la présentation en anglais, je crois. Donc, je vais continuer en anglais. The topic of my PhD was the reliable localization of mobile robots, especially by applying a constraint programming approach on dynamical systems that are used to describe robots. And I will not speak about everything about this topic, but only about an application of it. A temporal approach for a SLAM problem. And in fact, this application relies on all the tools that have been developed during the thesis. So mainly constraint programming and tools on dynamical systems, but we will only focus on this application here. I think it will be more interesting for you. And so what are our motivations for SLAM and for this new approach of SLAM? Well, we mainly work in our labs on marine robotics and especially on underwater robotics. And this comes with a lot of problems and challenging issues that we have to solve. And especially in this field, we go under the surface, and so we do not have any available GPS data, for instance, so it's difficult to perform a localization in this context. And for instance, here, when we have to explore some wrecks deeply located, or when we have to look for, as we have seen in currently, we are looking for the lost aircraft of the Malaysia Airlines, and so it's very difficult to go deep like this and to perform a mission without any localization support as we have in terrestrial areas or with the GPS. And so we have to find some alternatives like this. And one famous one, of course, is the SLAM. But the problem is that SLAM is simultaneous localization and mapping, of course. But we do not. It's difficult to apply the usual SLAM methods in our context because we do not have any points of interest or visible sea marks to rely on. Usually, what we have to consider is this kind of environment, very wide and homogeneous sea floors like this. And so we have to deal with this poor environment. So what we'll assume is that the robot is able to measure what we call the bathymetry, I mean the elevation of the seabed. And so a set of scalar values like this along its trajectory, and we'll only try to perform localization based on this set of data. So this is a kind of environment we can consider here. So the robot will perform some trajectory here and will only get the points corresponding to the elevation. So we'll try to formalize this problem with some equations just to see how we can solve it. So I'm just recalling here the classical state estimation equations. So the first one is the navigation equation. We have the state vector x of the robot described by a differential equation. So we have the evolution function here that can be nonlinear, for instance, or uncertain. And from previous states and the input of the system, we are able to depict like this the evolution of the system. In a second time, we have the observation equation related to the observation function g here. And so we have the measurement z expressed thanks to the states here. In this case, in our context, we know everything except the state, of course, and so estimate the state corresponds to a localization in our context. So if I come back to our application here, we can see that the main problem is that we do not have an analytical expression for the function g, in fact. will not be able to consider this equation here, which can be problematic for localization. But everything is not lost, and what we can do is perform what we call some intertemporal localization like this, consider intertemporal measurements. And more precisely here, the robot can perform what we call a loop, which means that it will come back to a previous position like this. For instance, the robot goes like this and comes back at this point. And at this very point here, the robot performed a loop. And so we'll try to compare the measurements done at each time here, the first time he was going through this point and the second one. And we'll compare the measurements and try to eliminate some feasible trajectories and try to perform a localization. So if I come back to the equations here, the first one, the evolution equation is still here, of course, because we have a proprioceptive sensors, so we are able to measure the velocities, etc. So we can perform dead reckoning. And the second one will not be usable, in fact. But as I said, we can rely on measurements and here on bathymetry. So here is a simple example of what we call by bathymetry. It's simply the sum of the altitude of the robot that can be measured by some sonar, for instance, and the depth of the robot measured by a pressure sensor. And we sum the two values and we obtain the bathymetry. Basically, it's the idea. And what we can realize is that the bathymetry, of course, does not depend on the altitude of the robot. In fact, the bathymetry only depends on the position, the horizontal position of the robot. So we are able to depict this equation here. We can say that if the robot comes back to the same position, the horizontal position expressed by the vector p here, if the robot comes back to the same position, then it should measure, again, the same bathymetric value, in fact. So we have this implication here. And so here is all that we have. So we'll try to build a SLAM approach on these equations here. The problem is, how can we deal with this implication here? It's not common, and it's not really easy to deal with intertemporal values like this. I will just close this. And so one naive approach for this resolution could be this one, for instance. So here on the left-hand side, you have the position plane here. So for instance, here it's a theoretical case. Okay, it's the actual trajectory of the robot. And as you can see, it performs a loop at this point here. So we have p at time t1 equal to p at time t2. And on the observation space here, we will have the bathymetry sensed along the trajectory of the robot here. And of course, at time t1, we have one value, and at time t2, we'll have the same again, because we performed this loop. So no uncertainties here. So this we know this information, thanks to the sensors, but we don't know the actual trajectory of the robot, of course. But instead, thanks to sensors with some noise, we'll be able to compute some estimations of it, like this one in gray here. And so also we can compute the times corresponding to the loop of the robot at this point here and project the times in the observation space here on the right. And as you can see here, we do not have identical measurements, so it means that we should be able to remove this false trajectory here. The estimation is not good. And we can do it several times like this. For instance, another one here. So this one, the loop is here. Again, the times does not correspond to the observation, so we'll remove it again. And we can do it several times, and sometimes we'll even have to consider false alarms, what we call false alarms, as it is the case here. For instance, we have a loop, and unfortunately here the loop is false, of course, but corresponds to, has a good representation in the observation space. So this can be quite heavy in computations, and it can be difficult to apply some particular algorithms, etc., on this case, especially if there is a risk to converge to a false solution. And to our knowledge in this work, there are no existing methods able to deal with this kind of problem here. If anybody in the room has some tips about it, I am open for the discussion. I'm really interested by some information about it. But to our knowledge, we do not have solutions for this problem. So our approach consists in working in a temporal space instead of the spatial space as we do usually. Here, what we'll try to do is to estimate the set of feasible times, the T1 and T2 here, such that we have loops corresponding loops in the space, the position space, and the observation space too. So we'll go into a temporal resolution. That's the main novelty of this work. So to do this, we will again define new equations. So we have the robot trajectory P here, evolving with time. So it's a 2D trajectory because we project it on the horizontal plane. And then we define looped trajectories by times. So it's a definition given by during the thesis of Clément Aubry in 2013. And here a loop is a trajectory that crosses itself, so we can define it by two times T1 and T2, such that we have identical positions and different times, of course. So here it's an example. We have a robot performing one loop here at times TA and TB, and we are able now to depict the loops in the temporal space. Here we have one vector in what we call a T-plane, so the set of feasible loops, in fact. And the robot can perform further loops like this, another one and a third one here, and we will have three vectors in our T-plane here. So it's now we will work mainly in this space in order to achieve the localization purpose. Okay, so the T-plane is a set of all feasible T-pairs here, and then we will define what we call a loop set, so the set of all feasible loops corresponding to this trajectory. And we'll call it TP star, so T for the loop set. The star is correspond in this representation to the actual values, the unknowns of our problem, the values we are looking for, in fact, without uncertainties. And P here, because the loops are related to the position of the robot. And so this definition here, so this loop set, is equal to the set of all the feasible T pairs, T1, T2, belonging to our temporal domain, such that we have identical positions. And just to avoid redundancies in our informations, we will also add this constraint T1 less than T2. And for instance, on this example here, the loop set TP star is equal to these three vectors here represented by red dots on the right-hand side. So we'll go a bit further in the equations. Here I'm just reminding the TP star definition. And of course, this loop set cannot be computed exactly because we do not have any knowledge on the actual trajectory of the robot, which is the one we are looking for. But we can rely on some measurements, and especially the velocity vector here, V, the velocities of the robot, the absolute velocities, available thanks to some sensors, and the measurements of the robot, Z, in our case, the bathymetry. And we are able to define two loop sets like this. The first one here, TP star, is simply a kind of translation of the first one here. We compute the integral between from T1 to T2 of the velocities, and we verify that this integral vanishes between these two times, which means that the robot's move, in fact, is equivalent to zero between T1 and T2, which means that we perform the loop. So this is for the first one, and we are also able to define a kind of loop set in the observation space called TZ star, and equivalent to the set of all the T pairs such that we have identical observations, in fact. And we will work on these two sets now. And I'm just recalling here the third equation of our SLIME equations introduced before. So you can remember here that we had an implication. If we have identical positions of the robot, then it means that we have identical measurements. And in this context now of temporal sets, this equation corresponds to a subset here, a subset relation. TP star here is in fact a subset of TZ star. And this will be used for the estimation in the temporal space, and then we will propagate this information in the spatial domain, in fact, in order to perform the localization. So I will give you some graphics just to understand a bit more these equations. I'm putting the equations here on this corner. For the first one, again, we have the same view here, so we were able to compute these points here, these vectors. And for the second one, Well, we will assume that we have this kind of measurements. So it's poor measurements, scalar values representing the bathymetry in our case. And from these measurements here, we will be able to compute this temporal set here, which is more awkward than the first one. So I could explain this shape, but it will take some time. But well, from this observation function here, from these measurements, we are able to obtain this set here. And finally, we will consider the third equation here, the subset relation. And what we can see is that we are able to overlap like this the two temporal sets. So the vectors fits in this place too. So the problem is that for now, no uncertainties at all. I'm only speaking about the actual values just to for the formalism. But in fact, of course, we have to consider uncertainties because our data comes from sensors. And so to do this, we'll use a set membership approach, so which is quite original compared to what we used usually in robotics. Here we will consider that all the uncertainties are known to be bounded within intervals, for instance. And we can also extend intervals to trajectories. And in this case, we'll speak about tubes. So for instance, here we have an uncertain trajectory, the unknown of our problem, for instance. And we will only assume that the trajectory lies within the tube depicted in gray here. And the tube X, depicted in brackets here, is defined by two trajectories that are the bounds of it, x minus and x plus, such that at each time one bound is less than the other one. And what is convenient with this representation is that once you assume that your trajectory belongs to the tube, then you can apply a set of operations on this set. So we can compute many arithmetic operations as we do usually, but only on bounds here, x minus and x plus. And this will allow to propagate the uncertainties in a reliable way among the computations. So we can transform our tube, etc., according to our problem. And at the end, we will still ensure that we did not lost our unknown here. So it's a powerful tool to make proofs and to guarantee our results, which is quite interesting for security reasons, for instance. And so in our case here, we consider a tube, as you can see here. So the tube is depicted in blue here, and the actual trajectory in white. And the tube is getting thicker with time due to accumulated drift. So we have some uncertainties accumulating with time. And the loops are here, and we will compute the loop sets based on this information. And because we have uncertainties, the loop set will be uncertain too. And on the right-hand side, it's the result from an algorithm, a CV algorithm, to compute the loop set. So we have again our three vectors, but now they will be enclosed within sets, in fact, due to this uncertainty here. If I zoom on it, you can see that these sets are these three shapes here. The actual vectors we have seen before are the black dots here, the TP star, in fact, vectors. And now we will only be able to consider them through their enclosure, which means this green sets. And so we'll work on the TP, so we remove the star, okay? We are now working on these sets, considering the uncertainties of our problem. And so I recall that here we are only in the temporal space. Okay, we do not work anymore here with spatial representations. So well, we have many things to say about how to understand these sets. For instance, here I just give an information. If I take this point here, which is not the actual one, okay, but we don't know where is the actual one. If I take this vector here, well, it means that this is a couple of times t1, t2, such that there exist a feasible velocities trajectory, a set of feasible velocities according to our sensors. It exists some V, so that belongs to our tube V, such that we have a loop, okay? Such that we have the integral between T1 and T2 that vanishes. So this point, in fact, could represent a loop in our problem, so we are not able to remove it. But everything in the blue space around these sets is surely not equivalent to a loop. And so we'll do the same also for the observations. So here on the right-hand side, we do the same. We get the enclosure of what we have seen before, these awkward shapes here. And now we will perform the fusion of everything. We'll try to perform the estimation in the temporal space. So I take this example here, just to zoom on it. We have this constraint of a subset. TP star is a subset of TZ star here. We know that TP star now is enclosed within this shape here, for instance. We have the same for the observations. And so now what we'll be able to do is a contraction like this. Quite simple, in fact, we'll simply perform the intersection between TP and TZ here. And we have been able, like this, to remove a lot of feasible loops, a lot of feasible T pairs in our temporal space. So we reduce the set of feasible solutions here. And now we will propagate this information to the spatial domain in order to perform the final localization of robot. So we'll compute the envelope of this set. We have intervals, T1, T2, for instance, here. And we'll propagate this information to the tubes of positions of the robot. Here, it's a theoretical example. We have a position tube here, P, okay, a one-dimensional tube. So we could say that at first, the robot is quite well localized, and with time, the robot gets lost. And from this information here, we will try to contract this tube, which means remove unfeasible trajectories according to our data. Basically, what it means is that we'll keep all the trajectories that go through this box here and also through this one here. Because what we try to compute, in fact, is this relation here. P at time T1 is equal to P at time T2. So in this approach here, we performed, in fact, estimation on the times. So the times are not system variables as we used to have, as we have usually, but set to estimate, in fact. And so from this information here, we are able to contract the tube like this. So we removed all the light gray part of the tube, as you can see here on this slide. And so we keep trajectories equivalent at T1 and at T2. So if I zoom on it, you can see that the contraction here is not an easy contraction, not only the intersection of the box and the tube. It's more complicated here because we have to consider all the trajectories that go through the box and consider the evolution of the trajectories along this time uncertainty T2 here, which has been a big study in the thesis, how to perform a state estimation in dynamical systems considering time uncertainties, which has been poorly studied in the community too. So we provided in the thesis an operator in order to perform this contraction here considering time uncertainties, and it is useful here in this context of SLAM. And so now we will apply this theoretical tools to experiments. And we perform C trials in Brest. So in Brest, we are more related to marine robotics and underwater robotics, and we have the chance to work with some specialists in this field. Especially here, we performed a dedicated experiment during the thesis, thanks to the GESMA, so formerly GESMA, now it's DGATN at Brest. And thanks to them, we have been able to use this big robot here named DORAD. So DORAD is an autonomous underwater vehicle, which means that we let DORAD perform its mission during 1 or 2 hours in Brest in an autonomous way. So we were waiting for it to come back to the boat. And during this mission, it performed a lot of loops like this underwater. So this is very convenient to work with our topics to be supported by these experts in this field. So this is another view of DORAD here, for instance, before the launch of the mission. And during the mission, during this 1 or 2 hours, we have been able to get a lot of data from this sensor. So here I'm just showing the evolution measurements obtained thanks to a DVL, okay, to measure the velocities of the robot. It's an acoustic sensor. So we have the velocities here. In fact, what you can see here is a tube. We have the uncertainties too embedded in this figure. And we do the same for the observations. Here is what we will use for our localization. It's the bathymetry sensed along the trajectory of DORAD here. So I don't go into the details of how we obtain this information, but basically it's based on the pressure sensor and the sonar. And then the results. So the robot started at this position here. It was quite well localized because it was able to make a GPS fix on the surface. Then it dives. And it started to perform a big cross over the area, like this. And as you can see, here we are computing first a dead reckoning method. So the tube is getting thicker with time, like this, because we integrate uncertainties on the velocities. So we have the white trajectory here, and in red, it's the box, the final envelope of feasible positions at the end of the simulation. And like this, the robot performed a survey over the area, as we do usually to explore an environment like this. So lines, parallel lines in one way like this, and then in the other way. So this typical pattern is in fact called a boustrophedon. It's a new word, so we have a joke in Brest, is how to, if you succeed to place this word in some discussion, you are a winner. it's the boustrophedon here, usually used for surveys in underwater environments. And so at the end, as you can see here, the robot is quite lost. Okay, its position box is quite important, and will try to localize itself. So this pattern here, the boustrophedon, is quite interesting because it leads to a lot of loops. In fact, here we have almost 100 loops, so a lot of information to process. And when we apply our algorithm, we have this result here. So we have been able to remove all the gray part here of the tubes, and so to contract the boxes as this one here, which is smaller, of course. And still, we ensure that we do not lose the actual trajectory, the unknown of our system, which means that on this slide here, we have guaranteed outputs. We are able to prove that, in any case, the robot is not outside this box, finally. And so this is another view, just to understand a bit more what the performance of the localization approach. In blue here, we have the dead reckoning method. So this graph represents the thicknesses of the tube, which represents, in fact, the drift of the robot with time. And of course, the robot is drifting in a linear way in our case with time, because we integrate velocities with some constant uncertainties. And if we apply our SLAM algorithm like this, we are able to reduce the drift and to something that could be almost constant with time. So at first, the robot is drifting because it is getting some information about the environment. Okay, no loops still at this point. And at some times here, we are able to compare the values with previous times, and so to apply the localization on this step. We have several solutions here. In fact, it's because our algorithm is run in some iterative way. So we compute it up to some fixed point here, where we are not able to do better according to our measurements. So that's about all. So now I'll conclude about this work. So we have been able to perform localization in some poor environment, only based on bathymetry information, which is quite difficult to use, only scalar values with time. And we did not have the knowledge about the observation function G. But we have been able to, by using some intertuple measurements, to perform the localization. So we have seen that this localization has been applied on bathymetric information in some underwater environment, but we could extend this approach to any kind of values, in fact. We could consider, for instance, temperatures, radioactivity, electric fields, etc., and perform a localization based on this kind of information, as long as this information does not evolve with time, in fact, of course. So we have performed the temporal resolution, which is original, and it has been a good occasion to study a lot of constraints on dynamical systems. And as we have seen in this presentation, constraints related to time uncertainties, for instance. So this comes with a set of tools that have been developed during the thesis and that are now available in the TubeX library. That is an open source software that you can download and use for your experiments. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions.